Good afternoon, board members and college staff. The time is 6:02 PM on this, the 26th day of August 2021, and I call this meeting of the Laredo College Board of Trustees to order. Mr. Delgado, can we have the prayer, please?
Yes, Madam Chair, thank you. Loving and gracious God, you're indeed the giver of all good gifts, and we thank you today for all your blessings, for the successful outcomes of our college events, and for our faculty, our staff, and most importantly, our students. We ask that you bless them abundantly as we continue to seek your wisdom, your guidance, your courage, and your strength. Be with us in our deliberations and help us to be wise in the decisions that we make for the good of all those who have placed their trust and their confidence in our leadership. Give us the insight to lead with integrity, that our decisions may reflect what is right and what is good. Dear Lord, grant us a humility to always seek your will in all that we do and all that we say. Amen.
Amen.
Hey, Mr. President, can you say something for the gentleman that passed away, all the servicemen and against that? Can you say a few words, please?
Yes.
Because you're good at it.
Well, I think a moment of silence would be more appropriate for that. So if pleases everybody, if we could have a moment of silence for all those who have passed, not only for the ongoing pandemic, but those for our men and women in uniform that have passed overseas. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Dr. Carranza. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Carranza.
Mr. Delgado. Judge?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, gentlemen. Ms. Ramos, could you please call roll?
Yes, ma'am. Lupita Cepeda?
Present.
Jorge Delgado?
Present.
Jackie Levin Ramos, present. Ms. Cynthia Mares. Mercurio Martinez.
Present.
Dr. Henry Carranza.
Present.
Esteban Rangel.
I'm present.
Karina Lizondo.
Present.
Tita Cantuvela.
Present.
You have a quorum, ma'am.
Thank you, Ms. Ramos. Let the record show that a quorum of board members is present, that this meeting has been duly called, and that notice of this meeting has been posted in accordance with the Texas Open Meetings Act. So Laredo College, August 26, 2021, public hearing for 2021 proposed tax rate and fiscal year 2022 proposed budget. Good afternoon. I am Lupita Cepeda, President of the Laredo College Board of Trustees. Today is August 26, 2021. We are convening a public hearing on the proposed 2021 Laredo College property tax rate and the proposed fiscal year 2022 budget. I will preside as chair of the hearing and now call roll. And roll has already been called. As background information for the public, the Laredo College Board of Trustees caused to be published on August 18, 2021. A notice of tonight's public hearing on the Laredo College proposed tax rate for year 2021 as required by Texas Tax Code Chapter 26. The Laredo College 2021 property tax rate is proposed to be set at 0.319441 per $100 valuation of taxable property, of which 0.252022 shall be for maintenance and operations, and 0.0674.9 shall be for debt retirement. If the Board of Trustees approves the proposed tax rate, this tax rate will raise more taxes for maintenance and operations than last year's tax rate. The tax rate will be effectively raised by 8%. Our public hearing today allows the proponents and opponents of the 2021 tax rate and the fiscal year 2022 budget to present their views to the Board of Trustees. Due to the health and safety concerns related to the COVID-19 coronavirus pandemic and pursuant to Governor Greg Abbott's executive orders and his temporary suspension of certain sections of the Texas Open Meetings Act relating to the public's participation, members of the public who desire to address the board during this public hearing on the 2021 tax rate and the fiscal year 2022 budget were given the opportunity to submit written comments at least 15 minutes before commencement of this hearing. Did we receive any written comments from members of the public? No comments? Are there any members of the public here today that wish to express their views regarding the proposed 2021 property tax rate and the proposed fiscal year 2022 budget to the Board of Trustees? If so, please approach the podium one at a time. The board will allow each proponent and opponent up to 3 minutes of time to present his or her views. According to Board of Trustees policy, CC Local, no officer or employee from the college is required to respond to questions from speakers. Please proceed to the podium. Do we have anyone? We have no comments. Thank you. The Board of Trustees is scheduled to adopt the Laredo College 2021 tax rate and 2022 budget during the board's regular meeting, which immediately follows the conclusion of this public hearing. This concludes the Laredo College public hearing on the 2021 proposed property tax rate and the proposed fiscal year 2022 budget. I will now entertain a motion to close the public hearing.
So moved, ma'am.
So I have a motion by Mrs. Ramos, and I have a second by Mrs. Vela. Any discussion? None heard. The final public hearing is now closed. So we're going to proceed to convene the regular meeting of the Board of Trustees. Mr. Muir, do we have to call? Do we have to roll call again for the regular board meeting?
Yes.
May I ask Mrs. Ramos for a roll call?
Yes, ma'am. Lupita Cepeda?
Present.
Jorge J.D. Delgado?
Present.
Jackie Levin Ramos? Present. Cynthia Mares?
Present.
Mercurio Martinez?
Present.
Dr. Henry Carranza?
Present.
Esteban Rangel?
I am present.
Karina Elizondo?
Present.
Tita Cantu Vela?
Present.
You have a quorum, ma'am.
Thank you, Mr. Ramos. Let the record show that a quorum of board members is present, that this meeting has been duly called, and that notice of this meeting has been posted in accordance with the Texas Open Meetings Act. Item number 3 is approval of the minutes for regular Board of Trustees meeting of July 29th, 2021, and special Board of Trustees meeting of August 4th.
Madam Chair.
I have a motion by Judge Martinez, and I have a second by Mr. Delgado. Any discussion? Chair hears none. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. I have our next item is public testimony. We have no one signed up. Thank you. The fifth item, we have recognitions, communications, introductions of personnel, and new personnel actions for the month. The first item is 5A is Get It to the Finish Line grant. Dr. Nora Garza.
Good evening, members of the board, Madam President. Nora Garza, for the record, I have two announcements of grants that we have. The first one is the Get It to the Finish Line grant from Rio South, Texas. We are proud to announce that Laredo College will receive $62,500 grant from Rio South, Texas to implement the Get It to the Finish Line Grant Project. Through the leadership and efforts of the Laredo College Economic Development Center, in collaboration with the Laredo College Student Success Center and the Laredo College Financial Aid Office, the project intends to assist individuals who currently attend or have attended Laredo College within the last 2 years and were unable to complete their associate's degree due to financial hardships caused by federal student aid regulations. The project will serve a total of 60 students who are less than 12 semester credit hours from completion of their degree. This program will begin spring 2022, and the Rio South Texas will also evaluate a future $62,500 grant. Our proposal has been accepted and now awarded. It will serve 60 students initially. So we're very proud of that and the work done by Mr. Michael Gonzalez, the Economic Development Center, the Financial Aid Office, and the others also mentioned. Thank you.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. Nora Garza for the record again. I'm very proud to announce this big grant that was submitted by Texas A&M University Kingsville, and it was submitted to NASA, and they were awarded $1.2 million for 3 years. I serve as the co-PI, and Laredo College will get $300,000 as well, and so we're part and parcel with it. Main efforts here is to increase the number of engineering students that start here and transfer to Kingsville, and also that want to minor in aerospace engineering, which is a new minor that they have. And so it's gonna be very exciting collaboration with them, and that now that we have a new engineering teacher that's coming on board, I'm sure we'll be working hand in glove and getting that started. So we're very pleased just to announce the tremendous efforts of Dr. Hua Li at Kingsville, who is a great colleague and friend who always thinks of Laredo College. Also mentioned and also part of it are South Texas College, Del Mar College, and Coastal Bend. So we're all in this together, and we're hoping to see a lot of really good students come through this project. Thank
great
you.
News.
Thank you. Great.
Thank you, Dr. Garza. The next item we have is TikTok Health Heroes Starter Kit Distribution Event. Dr. David Adesola.
Good evening, members of the board, administration. David Adesola, Vice President of Academic Affairs and Compliance. For the record, well, to inform you about an event we had in the middle of August, August 18th, TikTok, about a year and a half ago, we were awarded a grant by TikTok. It was called the TikTok Health Heroes Relief Fund, right? So the whole purpose of that grant was to help communities and help students get to school, succeed while they were in school, and graduate so they can go out there and help the community with the current and any future healthcare crises, right? So just as a reminder, Laredo College was one of only 10 institutions across the country that was awarded this this grant, and for more than that, the only community college, right? So the event, the way we organized the event with the help of Mr. Gonzalez and Obed Guerrero and his team, you know, we were able to purchase what we called TikTok Health Hero Starter Kits for the students, right? So these starting kits had stethoscopes, they had uniforms, they had digital instructional materials for the students. All in all, they were given, as well as some promotions, all in all, they were given a total of about $500 worth of stuff in their bag. So you see some of the pictures here, you see the students were waiting for their gifts there, like a kid on Christmas, right? And there they have all the gifts. So we did give them a lot of stuff, and then they were very appreciative. The uniforms that they were given to them were already, they were already measured for them. They were monogrammed or had their names on them and everything. So this is the entire group of the of the students that receive gifts, as well as our faculty and those involved in the nursing program. You see Dr. Miller there and some of our nursing faculty. And you see a little closer look at some of the things they received that day. And I want to add to this that when the board approved the tuition discount a couple of months ago, you add this, and this is the least expensive it's ever been for some of these students. So they're getting one great start at one low price here at the college. So I think it's worth just sitting back and you know, acknowledging that and what we've done for to make sure our students get started with low cost and on the right track on the ADN program. So these students will be able to graduate, go out there and help help us fight this pandemic.
Thank you.
Excellent.
Thank you, Dr. Edisola, and thank you, TikTok, to be able to help our students in the health field. Next item is 5D Campus Shield, Dr. David Arzola, Mr. Javier Cano, Mr. Jaime Castro.
Mr. Rangel, can you mute your phone, please? Sorry about that. Thank you.
Good evening again, members of the board. David Arzola, Interim Vice President of Academic Affairs and Compliance. For the record, I'd like to call up Mr. Javier Cano and Chief Jaime Castro up here. Just to provide a little context before I hand it off to them. About a year, ahead and a half ago, I know everything seems like one big blur, right?
But blur, right.
I took over safety and we formed the Health and Safety Operations Center. Over that year, if you think about what this college has gone through, you know, besides the pandemic, the winter storm, the microburst, the boil water notice. I mean, we've been through so many crises that it's been an unbelievable year. But one of the things that, you know, I picked up on, and we did as a group as well, is that we needed a better way to communicate with our community, right? With our college community, whether it be students, whether it be the public, whether it be faculty employees, and let them know what was going on campus. We have something, but you know, it wasn't all the way effect, right? So we did some research between all of us and we looked at some of the needs that we had in campus police, some of the needs that we had in safety, and we were able to acquire at a price just slightly less than what we were paying for our current system, a system called Campus Shield, right? It's a smartphone app. That will allow us to not only send mass notifications, it'll give students the ability to ask for help when they need them. But I'll let Javier and Chief kind of explain the rest of that, but I'll pass it on to them.
Thank you, Dr. Arzola, board administrators. Javier Cano for the record, and yes, we have been doing a lot of research. We did notice a need to be able to better communicate to our community. Especially in those moments that are critical. So through our research, we did find a company out there that works strictly with institutions of higher education. So it was a perfect fit from the start for us. This system that we purchased, this license that we have, allows us to do multiple things. So one, the mass notification. Two, the campus, the safety and security application that we're talking about, the mobile application. And then three panic buttons, right? And we'll talk a little bit about all three. But mass notification, we have access to communicate to our community via text, via cell phone, via email, which are the three main routes of communication, also in accordance to Texas Education Code. Another one is the mobile application, right? So I'm gonna go back slightly to the first. So what we're looking at here, if you look at the screen, the picture on the left-hand side, it's actually a mobile phone, right? So and I'm opening up my phone right now, but as you see, we have several features within the application itself. See Something, Say Something, Friend Watch, Campus Resources, Campus Police Services, and the COVID Health Assessment. So the emergency button slider, as you look at this, this is like the blue phones that we currently have on campus. Currently, we have here on campus, I believe, 19, maybe 21, if I'm not mistaken, blue phones. So in case of an emergency, a student or a visitor or an employee would have to go out there and one, know where the location is, or two, go out and find them, right? With this, it becomes the mobile blue beacon phone that we have out there. So with the slide of a button, the emergency call goes out to our emergency responders, which we've already identified a team, and primarily campus police, and they're able to go to that location of that person. So if I was to slide this at this time, Chief, you're here. that's how fast it would work.
Wow, he's fast.
No, but truly is. We've been testing this product for many, many months now. I must say, really the last 8 months, really it's just been a lot of trial, error, really trying to perfect the system and making sure that it does fit Laredo College and what we need here.
Can I ask a question on that?
Yes, yes.
So when you dial that, it automatically identifies your location?
Yes.
Is that for all cell companies?
Yes.
Okay. Yes. All cell companies have been tested?
Yes. Yes, we have. We've tested multiple phones, whether it's Android, whether it's iPhone. The other cool thing about this is a product or a product called geofencing. So what we've done is we've set up a fence around both campuses. So it'll pick up that you're inside that geofence and the alert goes straight to campus police.
Wow.
If it picks you up outside of that geofence, it'll redirect you to Laredo Fire, Laredo 911 Center.
Wow, okay, cool.
Yes, so it truly is in a moment's notice. You slide this. There's some other applications or some other cool features about it. You're able to put it in your widgets. For Siri, I'm able to call it, open it up. I'm able to slide this right. To kind of ease the use of it.
Is this app costing the students
to download it? No. We've purchased for full rights. Again, at a cost slightly lower than what we were paying for the product we know as LC Alert. So we're not going to rename it. It's going to continue to be LC Alert. We're simply using a different platform in the background to operate this. And we're also enhancing the mobility, right? The methods of communication.
Okay.
So again, mass notification, we can send out, we can target individuals in this particular room. We have a target, if we want to target only our board members, say board members, this is what's happening, our administrators. If I want to target a particular building, we have the names of those individuals that are assigned to that particular building. But again, the features are truly wonderful. We're very excited about this. Another cool feature that we're looking at and hopefully using here in the near future is the COVID health assessment. So, sir?
I have my COVID assessment badge.
You do it? Okay. That was fast, yes. So again, we're able to monitor. He has a badge now, so he's able to go through the different buildings without necessarily having to be rescreened again, right?
Wow.
But we're not at a launch date yet, right? We're looking at September 1st as a trial internal launch for employees. And then once we kind of get those quirks out, those little things that need to be addressed, we'll go ahead and do a full launch for the community, the visitors, and the students.
Awesome.
I'll pass it over to Chief here for the next products.
Good evening. Jaime Castro, Interim Chief of Police for Laredo College. Good evening, board members, Interim President. So the beauty of this app is that one, it creates the geofencing. Mm-hmm. We've already tested it where the officer literally stood 1 foot off. He slided it and it went to Laredo Police Department. Laredo Police Department called him and they called our dispatch saying, hey, you've got this person calling, and they set off an alarm. We were testing this at the South. We've tested it here as well, as soon as we left the campus geofencing. So that is one thing we've never had before. And so now we know, K-9 campus police knows exactly where that individual is going to be by using a map and a satellite image, right? It pinpoints where you're at. The other thing is that we have the latitude and longitude, we have the numbers that we need. The dispatcher will receive this, pops up on her screen or his screen, and they are communicating with the person. And while they're communicating, they're dispatching campus police. And on the same time, that dispatcher is able to input notes onto the screen. Why do we want that? Because we want to archive that for in case there is a case file, in case something does happen, we want to archive. So this is something we've never had before. Among this app, we're also going to have the campus police services. So people can see what kind of service is. So it might not be an emergency call, but they got locked out. And you'd be surprised how many students come onto campus, just like this time around. They don't know their layout of the campus. They don't know where a building is, and they think they're at the Fort Mac campus, and it's actually at the South campus. They get locked out. We have that all the time. We have students that, for whatever reason, their tire goes low. They need battery assistance, right? Or an escort from the classroom to their vehicle. So they can be able to look up on campus police services, and they will have those listings there. We also get a lot of the calls for other agencies. We work very closely with U.S. Border Patrol. Of course, we have them here. But they always call us for information as well. So this is going to be a beauty that they can also have on them. The student, of course, now uses cell phones. And we've also worked, as I mentioned to Mr. Perez, that we worked very closely with AT&T. And we've increased our cell phones by two more phones on campus, plus two more tablets. So now there'll be two cell phones at each campus where the supervisor and the officer will be receiving calls throughout the day and after six, plus a tablet that they will be using to, if somebody activates it, it will send an alert on that tablet as well. That tablet will also have the capability of looking at all the cameras that are on campus. You'll also see the See Something, Say Something. And we're building upon that. This is a federal program that started several years ago. Here at the college, we launched it off. And so we have students that have actually called us and gave us tips. They see something suspicious. They want to report a suspicious person. We've had employees do the same thing where they see something suspicious. I saw somebody sitting in a car, the windows were up, and the vehicle was turned off. That's pretty suspicious at 110 degree weather. We send the officers out there, we investigate, and we find out what's going on. So the See Something, Say Something campaign is very important for us, it's very important for the students, for the faculty, for the visitors. We want to make sure that everyone comes onto campus and is safe. Their learning experience is utmost number one, right? Because education is the most important thing. So we want them to be able to report something, even if it's anonymously, they can do so on this mobile app. So just to throw this in there also, all our mobile computers on our patrol cars have this feature set up. Okay? The dispatchers at both campuses have this feature set up. The lieutenants at both campuses have this feature set up in their desktops. I have this feature set up in my desktop as well. So if I'm working on something, somebody happens to alert it, it will override my screen and I have the alert. So we can be able to answer. If the dispatcher is taking another call, I can answer that dispatch. There won't be any lag time behind. All of this is for the safety and security of the students, the employees, and all the visitors that come to our campus. Questions? Wow.
Any questions?
Very good.
Chair recognizes Judge Martinez.
Will actually, with the all members of the faculty here at the college, will they be actually going through a training on what you just addressed? In other words, they will be taught what how to go about it, what to do, and at the same time also implemented within their cell phones.
Absolutely, Judge. Great question. And yes, we will be launching an actual. Start date. We will be doing training. We will be giving them guidance as to how it works and demonstrations. Now, throughout the year, of course, between campus police, safety, and the emergency response team, we will be doing, again, testing and drills so that we always maintain that that sense of urgency, right, and that response time where it needs to be when it counts.
Thank you.
Excellent question. Thank you.
Thank you.
Chair recognizes Mrs. Vela.
It's just a wow. It really is. It's amazing. You know, how all these apps and all this thing is just beyond me because, I mean, we're just not used to that. But this, it's really a wow. Congratulations.
It truly is. Thank you.
It really is. So I mean, it's.
This is something that we've been waiting for a long time.
I know.
And seeing how technology is constantly evolving and changing. Students, and I know this for a fact, because my two daughters, they're both in different universities, different places in Texas. But this phone follows them everywhere, and these students nowadays depend on everything, and so do
everything.
We.
Yeah.
And this app makes it so easy and such convenience, and the security that I don't have to go look for an emergency phone because I don't know where it's at. Mm-hmm. I can simply be in the classroom or at the Kaizen.
Wherever,
and I just slide it, and it activates it.
Wow.
So our response time, folks, is going to be under 3 minutes.
Wow.
Okay. Under 3 minutes.
Unreal.
Excellent.
Chair recognizes Dr. Carranza.
I'm glad that you guys came out with this phone because, you know, we're living in times where we need quick emergency relief. We're in our campus, as you know, is right next to the border. Our campus is an open campus. And it's more security. The word is security on top of everything. Security for our staff, for our faculty, and for our students. That's why I approve of phones like this, because this is what it is needed to protect our students and our faculty.
Absolutely.
Very, very good.
Thank you. Thank you.
Again, and this has been a road, right? A road that, you know, many, many months, lots of work, lots of hours that have been invested into this. We have not done this alone. Again, I would like to recognize members of the HSOC, the Health and Safety Operations Center, particularly Vilma Flores, who has spearheaded the implementation of the program and really making it ours, Laredo Colleges. Vilma?
Yep, thank you. All right.
Thank you.
So again, Board, I thank you for your time. And
just FYI, may I?
Chair recognizes Judge Martinez.
Just for your information, we're very fortunate that within a short period of time, we will also have the presence of the DPS, Department of Public Safety, in one of our facilities here, one of the buildings. And that, of course, also will be, in our opinion, a plus, because in addition to the presence of our own law enforcement personnel here, the presence also of DPS will also in our opinion, will be of a benefit to this particular campus, particularly more so. So that's just, I don't know if you were aware of that, but that is one of the pluses that, in our opinion, it's certainly going to be a benefit to our community here.
Absolutely, Judge. I work very closely with Sergeant Coleman. Okay. Sergeant Coleman is and myself, we're both tactical instructors. The other thing I'd like to mention, since you brought up DPS, is that we will also be sharing this app with the agencies that are here on campus, DPS, right, the Curative, the Literacy Volunteer, all these agencies that are here. We're going to be sharing this app with them because it's vital that they have this, so we will respond because, of course, as you mentioned, Judge, we are the law enforcement agency here in the campus, and it's a great thing that we have DPS here to also assist us along with the other agencies. But I wanted to just let you know that we will also share this app with them. We have their contacts. We're going to be sharing this, so if in case something does happen in those areas, we will be notified and we will respond.
Excellent.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Chair recognizes Ms. Mares.
Thank you, Madam Chair. And just as a follow-up to everything that's been said, you know, kudos to all of you for putting all of this together. And I would just hope that, I know you have to train the faculty, you're gonna roll it out to faculty and to employees here. And let's try to see how fast we can then roll it out to the students, because mm-hmm. that's also a very important topic. And we're gonna spend a whole semester and things can happen, hopefully not, but let's hope that, you know, everybody, I'm sure, will catch on to this. Everybody's on to all these apps and stuff, that we roll it out and market it as best as possible to our students as soon as possible. So thank you. Thank you all for the hard work. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you very much for everything.
Once again, thank you all for your support.
Chair recognizes Ms. Vella.
You know, the majority of our students are so savvy, you know, and they can't,
this is gonna be a piece of cake.
It takes me a long time, but, I mean, they just.
They'll probably teach us before we start.
Absolutely, you know, it's incredible.
That's wonderful news, excellent.
I know, that's wonderful. Thank you. Thank you, David.
So, no, thank you all for your support.
Thank you, Doctor.
My last slide here was just gonna be that you can download the app for free. I know some of you have already downloaded it. It's available on both Apple and Android phones. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, great news, starting with Dr. Nora Garza and Dr. David Arizola's team. Thank you very, very much for everything on behalf of the board, Dr. Tijerina as well. Thank you for everything you continue doing for our students and our staff and our administration. Chair recognizes Dr. Tijerina.
Dr. Marisela Tijerina, interim president for the record. I have other two communications to report. One is to remind the board that this coming Tuesday, August 31st at 10:30, we will be conducting our press release for our second bachelor's degree, which will be the Bachelor of Applied Science in Organizational Leadership. So I'm very proud again that THECB, the Texas Higher Education Coordinating Board, has approved our second bachelor's degree, and it is pending SAC COC approval, which hopefully we'll hear sometime in December. But we're definitely gonna recruit this semester and announce that on Tuesday. So all board members are invited to this press release. And second major announcement is that for the second time in the row, we are the number one Texas community college.
Woo!
So we will also be doing a press release on that as well. Before I introduce the new personnel, I also want to, he doesn't know this, but I want to recognize Mr. Luciano Ramon, as this will be his official last board meeting, and I'm gonna hand this to Dr. Fred Solis to do further announcement. Or recognition, rather.
He's got no business retiring.
He's too young.
He's still very young.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen of the board, Madam President, Interim President Tijerina. It gives me a great pleasure to recognize an individual who has given 37 years of his life to this institution. And looking ahead, there's only 24 hours left before he actually leaves us, not counting tomorrow, but nevertheless, I would call to the front Mr. Luciano Ramon. If you can come over. On behalf of the college, Luciano, and the division, on your retirement, we thank you for 37 years of dedication, and I know you have plans to travel, and so may you enjoy your upcoming adventures. And so on behalf of the college,
you can't drive.
We thank you. Dr. Tijerina also has.
Thank you all very much. It really means a lot to me. And I want to thank the college for the opportunity that it gave me. Thank you very much.
Mr. Ramon, you will be missed.
Yes.
Yeah.
You dedicated yourself, your whole entire career to Laredo College. So on behalf of the board, and I'm sure all the board members would like to say something, but I got to work with you through AT&T as well, and you were always there for us, and thank you for your years of service. And enjoy retirement.
Exactly.
Anyone else? Chair recognizes Mrs. Ramos.
Mr. Ramon, thank you for the years of service that you gave to the college, but not only that, for giving me an opportunity to work alongside with you to make this college what it is, and I really appreciate it, and I'm honored to have served with you, alongside with you on the board as well, and thank you so much for your service to our community college and to our community as well. Thank you, sir.
Yes. The chair recognizes Mr. Delgado.
Mr. Ramon, yes, definitely thank you so much for all that you've done, your commitment. I think we've had the pleasure of working together over the past 3 years, and definitely grateful for the experiences as well as the advice that you've given along the lines, especially in learning so much throughout the intricacies of this amazing institution. And I know well wishes on behalf of my parents as well to you. I know you know them well, so thank you very much for your commitment and for all your service. And if for any reason you want to come back out of retirement, but hopefully everything goes well. I pray that you enjoy your travels and that you see the entire world. So exactly. Good luck to you.
Exactly. We go around. Chair recognizes Mrs. Mares.
Thank you. Luciano, gosh, we went a whole span of, I don't know, over 20 years, I think. When I met you, you were 20 years old, and you still don't look a day over 20. So I don't know what you're doing. Give me the recipe. But this college was very fortunate to have you on board, just like, of course, we have many other valuable, everybody's a valuable employee, but I saw you grow, and in the knowledge and the contributions that you made to this institution in the technology area. And so, it's come a long, long way thanks to your commitment and your hard work. So, de todo corazón, gracias. And yes, please enjoy your retirement because, you go back to work, yeah, no te quitas de ahí. So, God bless you, and we take care.
Chair recognizes Ms. Elizondo.
Mr. Ramon, congratulations. I know 37 years sound very easy, but I'm sure it was very, very busy and tired journey. Nonetheless, based on what everybody says, and you have done an amazing job, and I have no doubt in my heart that you will continue to do an amazing job wherever you go, whether it's enjoying time with your family. And I just want to say thank you for everything you have done for the college, and congratulations.
Chair recognizes Dr. Carranza.
Yes, I've known you for quite a few years prior coming to the college, so hey, I hope you have a good time. That's all I can say, because I'm having sort of a good time.
Chair recognizes Mrs. Vela.
Enjoy. Keep busy.
I'm trying.
Judge?
I'm trying.
Chair recognizes Judge Martinez.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Mr. Ramon, obviously, you have been an exceptional asset in bringing in the type of experience and technology, frankly. Particularly more so, you have had quite an impact because there is quite a bit of interference on the Mexico side within our media on this side. And through you, you have been able to actually improve this technology and try to cut down on the interruption or the interference that unfortunately continues to once in a while we experience. But obviously, we're going to miss you, and at the same time, we certainly wish you the very best. And I particularly want to thank you because you have been an exceptional technology individual in helping our college. So thank you so very much.
God bless you, Mr. Ramon. Dr. Tijerina.
Dr. Tijerina, interim president for the record, and just to quickly announce the reclassification, new hires, promotion, we have Juan C. Tovar, Rebecca Herrera, Andrea Lopez, Olga Vasquez, Miguel A. Aguedo, Dr. Michael Bailey, Jesus E. Carizales, Norma E. Achar, Jennifer A. Hernandez, Dr. Duncan Liu, Francisco Mancias, Blanca I. Mangana de Corona, Norma L. Martinez, Jaime C. Perez, Jessica L. Rodriguez, Francisco Ruiz III, Jacqueline Villalón, Antonio Villarreal, and lastly, Eva Villarreal. So for the sake of time,
thank you.
Hopefully they stood up.
Welcome to Laredo College. Thank you, Dr. Tejerina. Is that a conclusion? Next item we have is a faculty senate report. Do we have Mr. Masenhani? Oh, there he is. Mr. Vela covered you, sir.
Kind of makes it hard when you put me after all that stuff, right? Good evening, for the record. Associate Professor of Government Prakash Mansinghani and President of the Faculty Assembly. I'll make my report short today. I just have a few items coming from the faculty that I wanted to bring to the administration as well as to the Board of Trustees. And so good evening, members of the board, as well as President Tejerina as well. And President of the Board, Ms. Bella as well.
Thank you.
So again, I'll make the report very short. I know that the board has met recently and is continued on that process for the presidential search. So I just wanted to take a moment to thank the board for all that work that it's doing, because ultimately, those of us who are in the college, in the trenches, right, every single day, will be affected by this individual's work every day. And so really, it's going to affect us. I know it's going to affect you all as well, but of course, it'll affect us on every day. So definitely, I very much appreciate the work that y'all are doing to set up those parameters to make that process fair and to make that process good for all of us. I'm very confident that we'll find someone for this college. So we're very excited and looking forward to play a role in that process. I know I've said that before, so I won't belabor that point. And of course, the faculty, including myself, is available and ready should the administration or board call on us. So I just wanted to reiterate that from the summer without getting too much into it. The next item is a big ticket item, so I feel like it's the first time in a year that I've come up here to the board, to the administration with the big item, so I'm glad everyone's sitting down. Two big items, mind you, so. As you all know, the college held its convocation about a week or so ago, August 19th, if I'm not mistaken, we had a convocation. The Faculty Senate or Assembly had its first meeting of the year. And of course, I wanted to give updates to the faculty about a lot of the things that the board, the administration, and the college has been working on over the summer, so I did that. The other thing is I wanted to, as I do at the beginning of my first meeting, is kind of gauge the faculty on a number of different issues, because it's hard for me to talk to all of them, and they don't always have the time to attend the meetings. One of the things I was curious about, because it's such a pressing issue right now, is regarding, obviously, COVID and where all of the faculty and really the employees, but I only have, right, the, I wouldn't say authority, but right to be involved in engaging the faculty, not the employees. So one of the questions that I put up in a poll to our faculty was about, it's a little, you might get twisted if you read that question, so I'll read it for you. One of the questions in the survey that I'd administer to our faculty is, should the college require students and employees to wear masks inside a building or a classroom? Now, I'm aware of all of the guidelines and all of the things that are happening and the governor's actions and so forth, but I definitely didn't want to come up here and comment on that matter unless I had some wherewithal or some understanding of where the faculty is. You can see that on that question, about nearly 80%, in this case 75.6% of the faculty believed that the college, if it could, it should mandate that individuals and students wear, employees and students wear a mask on campus while inside a building. And the sample size is over half of the faculty. And you know, for those of you who did the polling, you know, you never need the full number, you just need a sample size. Right. And I've got a good sample size here with which to work with. And so the reason that I brought this up to the board is because I'm a member, as so are many other employees of the college, the Texas Community College Teachers Association, who just sent out a mass email yesterday because the TCCTA has its lawyers and all of that sort of stuff. And so I didn't solicit their opinion, but they contacted all of the representatives yesterday with an update with regards to all of the questions that they've been getting from faculty, administration, staff, mm-hmm. about COVID. And one of their retainers, the lawyers on retainer, is her name is Monica Narvaez. And again, this is just one lawyer's opinion. Obviously, the field is very complicated. Again, I didn't solicit this opinion, but the opinion from this lawyer that came down yesterday, that was sent directly to me from the executive director of the Texas Community College Teachers Association, again, sent to all of us in the organization. Her opinion, and I quote, reads, under the law, mask mandates are all over the place because of the fight between the governor and the various county officials in Texas, most notably Dallas. As of today, mask mandates are allowed while the litigation plays out. Short story, in her opinion, a college is within its rights to mandate masks even if there's no underlying county order where they sit until the Supreme Court says no. Now, I know the Supreme Court had a ruling a few hours ago. My understanding, and I'm not a lawyer, obviously, we do have counsel today, and other people who understand these matters more, is that it was limited in scope based on the appeals in San Antonio. Right now, there's only a temporary injunction against the governor fining governmental entities that issue mask mandates. So the reason I'm speaking on this issue, and as you can see here, this is not a political issue. As you know, Dr. Tijerina and me meet regularly on this item, and we both agree there's nothing political about a mask. No. The mask is, in fact, the least political thing and the most scientific thing. So the only reason I brought it up is because, again, it's far from me to be making these sorts of decisions, but it is important for me at least to kind of give you an idea where the faculty are in terms of this issue. And so I'll say briefly, as we see what's happening in the community, we look back at last year, in the spring of 2020, you know, Laredo College and the city of Laredo, but in this case, the Laredo College was among the very first colleges in the nation, certainly in the state, to announce that it was gonna go virtual. And I think that that was the most important and the most, and the boldest decision that we've seen at this college, and it really, really, really made a difference. And of course, success was maintained and integrity was maintained. And as I see it, 2020, was the year of lockdowns. I think that year is over. I mean, everyone has a different opinion on lockdowns, but I don't think 2021 is any longer going to be a year of lockdowns. It's just they're too difficult financially, too damaging, and also on people's mental state. Mm-hmm. Our country is very different from other countries, and so I don't think that is what's going to happen this year. In my personal opinion, today or this year is the year of masks and vaccines. I think that will be, at least for now, the solution. And I do feel, at least personally, that we're on the precipice of another full-blown pandemic once again. And unlike last year, this year we have a new answer. And namely, that answer is backed by science, and that answer is masks. I will go on to say that this college is leading once again in the area of COVID-19 with the protocols that, and again, Dr. Dean has been very stringent about, which is temperature checks and screenings that every faculty member has to institute in their classroom, and when we are at the leading edge of that, and it is amazing that we get to do that sort of stuff. In conclusion, on this particular issue, I would say that the difficulty that a board faces isn't just the political one with the restraints placed on the governor or the governor's restraints placed on us, but also weighing between personal choice, personal freedom, and responsibility. And I always hear people say, isn't this a free country? Why do we have to wear a mask? It's a free country. But with freedom comes responsibility, and we have a responsibility. And so that's why, in my opinion, this is just me sharing the faculty's views on all of this as they mature and as they evolve, that the board and the administration continue to look at this as it has and see what can be done. We were a leader in 2020. We continue to be a leader today. And I hope we can continue to make those bold decisions, and I know others will follow suit. And sometimes it's tough, just like that border decision, granting easement to the federal government and denying that easement, bold leadership. And I think that who knows whether this issue calls upon that. Far be it from me to make that decision, but I definitely wanted to share my thoughts, and again, the faculty's thoughts, because, and I hate to go here, but a lot of people are scared. Mm-hmm. And and for good reasons. It's a very tough situation out there. Having had that disease and having seen people who lost people, not political, not occupational, it is just, as I said last year, life and death is what it comes down to. And you know, I walk around the classrooms because we have to ask our students to abide by this. The governor's given us very little choice. And it's hard because in some classrooms, all of the students adhere, and yet in others, there's the brazen one, you know? I just heard a comment yesterday. I have my governor's mandate to do what I want. I will not put it on. So, wow. So it's complicated. It's a tough situation, and we're doing the best that we can, and I believe that we are. And so I just wanted to share that. Since you're still sitting, the second one, and that's the last one. As you all know, over the summer, I've come to the board since our conversations back in January about the cost of living adjustment. Tough times, but tough times call for tough recommendations. And so we've put together the what that looks like, right? I know I've hammered that point for the better part of 3 or 4 months. And on the left, you can see, and by the way, before I forget, I should have began with this, but I'll bring him up for the reason that this comes up. It's Mr. Ramon, on behalf of the faculty. You were a faculty member as well in the CIS department, and I'd like to congratulate you on your retirement because you've earned it. So, on behalf of faculty, please. And the reason I bring up Mr. Ramon is because Mr. Ramon and I share something, which is what I have in front of you, is that as Faculty Senate Assembly President, whenever we come up here, we use the podium not just to advocate for our fellow faculty, but to advocate for our fellow employees. And so these figures in front of you represent the cost of any kind of adjustment on the left, whether it be a long-term commitment, which is a COLA, or a one-time bonus on the right. But my understanding is that these figures, again, are for all employees. Mr. Luciano and I, Mr. Ramon and I, have always been very dedicated to making sure that we advocate for all employees, because the faculty can't do their job well or at all. I know that Ms. Bella, you know, former faculty, and so are others. You know, we can't do it without the advisors, without the administrators, and so forth. So again, these are some of the costs. I know it's a tough decision, and that's why I didn't come here with any particular recommendation to this particular board or to the administration. But just to see if the board can look at these numbers and see in these tough times, can something be done? You know, because sometimes we do have faculty who make a lot, and then we have those who don't. And so it's tough, and we gotta watch out for everyone. And of course, as I've been reiterating all summer, and as well as all spring, at the end of any of my presentations, is that I particularly, and on behalf of the faculty, and am incredibly grateful to the board, who gives me the opportunity to come up here and make these presentations, and to Dr. Rodriguez-Tiquina as well, who gives me the opportunity to sit down with her and meet with her. And I mean, on a personal note, Dr. Tina, again, congratulations and thank you. She's one of my mentors here, so I am where I am today because of you. So she's like, don't give me that credit. But thank you for the opportunity to speak. These are the recommendations on behalf of the faculty today.
Thank you,
Mr. Masahani. Appreciate all the information you just gave us.
Thank you.
Next item we have is a classified staff council report. Ms. Dominguez.
Good evening, board president, board members, Dr. Marisela Tijerina, interim president, professional staff, and guests. Rosario Dominguez, president of the Classified Staff Council, for the record. Hope you all are staying safe and in good health. As I am stepping down from office, it has been my pleasure to have served as your Laredo College Classified Staff Council organization president. These past 2.5 years have been my greatest challenge and most rewarding experience. I would like to thank everyone that has supported me and encouraged me throughout this journey. On August the 16th, at our annual convocation meeting, an online platform using Google Forms was conducted for the new election of officers for 2021 through 2023. Our next classified staff council president will be Cira Hernandez, and she's right here. She will be our next classified staff organization president. Thank you, stay safe, and many blessings. We are Laredo College strong.
Thank you. Welcome, Ms. Hernandez. next item, we're gonna go to the consent agenda. We have 8A is July 2021 financial report. Mr. Cesar Vela.
Madam Chair.
Yes.
If I may.
Chair recognizes Ms. Mares.
I'd like to make a motion that we approve items 8A, 8B, and 8C under consent agenda.
Do I have a second?
I second.
Second by Judge Martinez. Any discussion?
Second.
None heard. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries.
Thank you.
Thank you. Discussion and possible action on 9A, fiscal year 2022 budget and 2021 property tax rate. Mr. Cesar Vela.
Good evening, members of the board. Dr. Tijerina, for the record, Cesar Vela, Vice President of Finance. Before we proceed to the adoption of the budget, I would like to go over some items that came up as part of the budget workshop. I believe we had some questions that the board had asked regarding the budget. Mm-hmm. And if I may, I'll start with one of the items that was brought up at the budget workshop was a question regarding the increase in the community relations account. We have an increase for the year of $35,698. And that's attributed to the cybersecurity program requesting funding for next year. And this is primarily for the National Cybersecurity Awareness Month that is coming up in October. They are proposing to invite a speaker and provide promotional items for this event. And then we do have two new programs that came on board. The Homeland Security Program is again also asking $5,000 for next fiscal year, and this again is for promotional items to engage the community and industry stakeholders. And then we also have in the student services area, there is a request for community engagement funds to be used for off-campus outreach activities, meetings, and trainings. So again, the major increase was in the cybersecurity, and that is to cover expenses for the National Cybersecurity Awareness Month in October. Any questions on that one item?
No. Any questions from anybody?
Thank you. No.
Appreciate it. No. The next item was on the 75th anniversary celebration. There was a request for $75,000, and we did receive the breakdown for that. We have a request of $15,000 to cover the events, and the rest will go to advertising. And again, this is to promote the programs and for enrollment advertising. The breakdown, they've requested $25,000 for TV ads, $15,000 for radio, and $15,000 for billboards as part of the 75th anniversary. On the item of the presidential search, regarding the last presidential search expenditures, the expenditures totaled $62,164. We did have a base fee of $35,000 that was paid to the Association of Community College Trustees, which was the firm that led the presidential search process, and approximately $22,000 in travel expenditures for the candidates that were brought down for the interviews.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
How much was
Chair recognizes Mrs. Vena.
How much was the total that we spent?
Total was $62,164.
Thank you. Chair recognizes Mrs.
Ramos. Mr. Vena.
Yes, ma'am.
Can you separate the 22,000 in travel expenditures? Like, where did it go to? Like, who did it go to? Like,
yes.
Like the candidates. What else, you know, what else was the money utilized for?
Yes, we actually do have a breakdown by candidate.
Okay.
And then again, there were some travel expenses that were reimbursed to the Association of Community Colleges for their staff that came their down staff. To lead the process.
Right.
So those are broken down. The base fee is separate. Travel for the staff from the Association of Community Colleges, and then the reimburse the travel for the candidates.
Okay, and also for some of the other expenditures, right?
Yes, that's okay. Correct, yes. And the last item that I have is, any questions?
No. Chair recognizes Mr. Delgado.
Actually, if you could go back to the comments that you made about the 75th anniversary, just correct me if I'm wrong, but it's $55,000 that's being allocated for advertising?
It is
25
in total.
That is correct, sir. Mm-hmm. I'm sorry, it's
because you gave me 25, 15, and 15 for TV, radio, and
yes, sir. That's correct.
Okay, and is that money coming from marketing, or is this just an additional to what marketing currently has?
This is a separate line item, yes, sir.
Right. And then the rest, what is it being used for?
I'm sorry. The
$75,000.
$15,000 is the difference of $15,000 is there's a series of events that are planned,
mm-hmm.
And again there's a gala for $7,000, and then there's three small events, and the cost for those are $3,500 and for two of them, and $1,000 for one event. Now they did not identify what those events were, but that's the breakdown that we've been given so far.
Thank you.
Is that
Chair recognize Mrs. Vela?
Is that a done deal, the 75 and all this money?
If we go on it.
I mean, I'm just scared because of the time. Mm-hmm. I don't know if it's the right time to do it. I mean, I'm sorry, but I'm scared too.
Right now, we're not able to do anything.
I know.
Then the money stays there, right? Yeah. It's not spent.
That's correct. Or it could be repurposed in case there's a certain need in another area.
It
yes.
We just need to really look
and,
at it.
And that is, again, this is a set aside right now in the budget, but again, as these events and items come up forward, they'll be brought to the board for approval.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Chair recognizes Mrs. Ramos.
So could we say that we set aside the money right now, but we do look into the fundraising mm-hmm. options also as well.
Yes, ma'am.
And that money would not be used and that it would stay there. So that if we do fundraising, especially for the gala, that our aim is to fundraise mm-hmm. and to be able to recuperate as much money as possible from what we're putting out, right?
Yes, that could be an option, yes.
Okay, I highly would like to recommend that to be an option, first and foremost, and you know, hopefully, it might be considered.
Okay.
Chair
recognizes Ms. Mares.
Thank you. And I kind of participated several years back on a similar, you know, situation with the Alumni Association. I think that will always be an option, hopefully, that when you embark on setting aside and say, we're going to have this big project, you know, that obviously fundraising would, you know, tie into that because that's what you want to do. You want to bring in the additional money so you don't tap into your own resources. I think that's a given, pretty much so. But I kind of want to, you know, coattail on Ms. Vela because I like to say that, yes, okay, let's put it in reserve. But, you know, I think within the next semester, we should be able to gauge where we're going, you know, and whether the community is going to respond. I don't think the community is going to respond to a virtual gala. Mm-hmm. I mean, and maybe you can just go and do the fundraising and with some minimal promotion of our institution and obviously all the accolades and the faculty, the great faculty and employees, great employees that we have, that is on set. I mean, that goes with all of that celebration. But I'd like to also maybe just, leave it there. But let's wait and see, and then, you know, some committee or the alumni is going to come together, and then with the administration, everybody making recommendations, and then we'll bring it back to the board and say,
yes. And if that, again, the direction would be for us to bring those events and to the board, we'll bring them back, and again, for approval. Like I mentioned, right now, it is a line item just in the budget, but again, that doesn't mean that the events or would be approved.
Now, on the nonprofit side of the house, that I serve on several boards, they've done very well on virtual events.
Yeah, they have.
And it is the fact of everybody working and looking for sponsorships and different things.
Yeah.
So it can work, and we can raise money if we work at it.
And raffles and stuff, yeah, you can have a raffle, all these big raffles.
Well, sponsorship is your biggest.
Sponsorship, exactly.
Ticket. Fundraising. Yeah. So we work hard at it. We can bring in money, especially for the college.
Right.
Chair recognizes Ms. Vela. I'm sorry.
Well, you know, that is right what you're saying. They have made a lot, and I know the auctions and stuff that they have, it's been very successful. So maybe something like that.
Sure.
Or I think I mentioned that the other day, is piggybacking on another, thing like the Children's Fun Fest or something, and having something special that day.
And that is part of the plan, that as
Which
we have those
nice.
Events, we are going to promote the 75th year anniversary.
I mean, we have to promote it, though.
Yes.
Any other questions?
And then the last item that we have also has to do with the insurance. We did look, right now the budgets that we have for property insurance and general liability.
I'm sorry.
Oh, yes.
Are
you
in item 9A2?
We're not there.
9A, yeah. Mm-hmm.
On the insurance, we budgeted $363,200 for insurance. Right now, we have received a proposal for next year's premium, and that came in at $376,746. So actually, we're short $13,546 right now. But again, the budget is a living document, so we'll make adjustments to cover the cost. Now, the increase, again, what we have been told is, again, increases throughout the state. Again, the winter storm damages have contributed to increases in premium. For us, the college did increase property values. We did add the College of Health Sciences building. And we've also had a total of $818,000 in claims in the last 2 years.
Wow.
So that is also $818,000 in claims.
Wow.
And how many years?
In 2 years.
In 2 years.
Between storms and winter damage.
Winter damage, yeah.
For an institution of this size, and in my opinion, it's not bad.
Yeah. And the coverage is
one claim is going to run you $200,000 to $300,000.
Yeah.
Now, one item that we requested when we asked for proposals was that to have a fixed amount on our deductible. Some of the companies were not able to provide that. Obviously, they're offering a percentage of as a deductible. So, for example, 1% would be a $2.2 million deductible for us. So obviously right now the proposal that we have received is a $500,000 deductible. Now they did offer for us to pay down on that deductible, but the cost to bring it down to $100,000 would cost about $170,000 in addition to the $376,000. To bring it down to $250,000, which is our current deductible, would be around $57,000. In addition to the $376,000. So right now we're still working on that, on those proposals. But again, that was one of the questions that we had. We were looking at the budget. The budget was set at $363,000. Right now the proposal that we have in place is $376,000.
Sounds good.
Any questions?
Any questions?
Madam Chair.
Chair recognizes Ms. Mares.
You've already covered some of the questions and the issues that we had the last time, right, Mr. Vela?
Yeah.
Yes.
All right, Madam Chair, if I may, and this is, might sound like a dumb question that I'm going to pose here, but, and I think I know the answer, but I'd still like to put it out there. Once we've adopted this budget, let's say like tonight's presentation on the cost of living and down the road, or we decide to do something, you know, for all our employees, like we've done in years past, mm-hmm. the one-time bonuses or whatever. We could pass a budget tonight and then work on that conceivably, and obviously find the money. You know, that's the whole big issue. Where's the money gonna come from? Yeah, we wanna do this, but where's the money gonna come from? But then we could down the road, you know, make those amendments, right, to the budget and then present and as an item and say, the board is now approving that we do this X, Y, Z for our employees.
Yes.
And we recognize and work with, you know, with staff and, you know, to identify potential, you know, monies that could be let go from one because it's not being used.
And that's correct, Ms. Mares. We can, like I mentioned, it's a living document. It's based for our fiscal year. It's our planning document. Mm-hmm. Things change throughout the year, so at any time we can come back and revisit the budget, mm-hmm. and amendments can be made to the budget, whether it be that we got more revenue that mm-hmm. we were expecting,
exactly.
or in a right. bad situation, mm-hmm. we
right.
are not gonna make
right,
the
make
revenue,
also,
and
yeah,
we have to
course.
Make an amendment to bring it down.
Definitely,
yes.
And obviously if there's an increase and that can always spur the conversation, as you say, that we can bring it back as an item on the board, because that's a topic I think that, you know, has been looming over this board, you know, but we haven't, at least myself, haven't delved into it to say, well, let's really explore. I don't think we've ever put it on the agenda to say, I mean, we had some figures tonight, but you know what I'm saying?
Yes.
So, you know, so I think that maybe down the road, we have that option open to us, and then more carefully and slowly, you know, either through the finance committee, you know, let them, you know, peel that onion more, and then, you know, then we come back to this board and then look at something. We've done things in, like in December. Once you get a mid-semester type of a feel for how the numbers went and monies or no monies, and then we've given stuff out, you know, made changes and given something to our employees even all as late as November, December. So, but thank you. Thank you, Madam Chair.
I'm gonna recognize our legal and then I'll recognize you. Recognize Mr. Mira.
Thank you, Madam President and board members. The only caution I would give you is that there are some legal issues that have to be looked at when it comes to providing additional compensation after employees sign contracts. There's gift of public funds issues and other matters. We've encountered those in the past. As a general rule, you know, awarding additional money compensation after an employee signs contract is disfavored. So there, we'd have to just look at those issues
right.
at
yes.
the right time.
Thank you.
Chair recognizes Ms. Elizondo.
Thank you. Actually, it's a question for council. Will you recommend for us to table this item to further discuss the possibility of COLA? As we all know, Mr. Mazzangani has addressed this issue a couple of times since the summer. Unfortunately, since it's under staff reports, we're unable to discuss. But I'd like to, I would like to echo Ms. Mares's sentiment, and I think that it's an item that I would like to further discuss any possibility of how much it will cost or any projected cost given the if we were to approve COLA. But I honestly feel I don't feel comfortable approving a budget without actually addressing this item. So I don't know if it will be a recommendation of council to table this until we not only discuss faculty
table.
COLA, but in general, but for all staff.
Chair recognizes Mr. Muir.
Yes, so the Texas Higher Education Code 51.005 obligates the College Board of Trustees to adopt a budget
mm-hmm.
by September 1. So you'd have to adopt the budget before September 1. And we would not be able to table that item. Let's see, today is the 26th.
Yeah, we don't have time.
Yeah,
it has time.
I mean, I suppose you could. Yeah, but then you can't adopt a tax rate
right.
until you first adopt a budget. And if you push that back, there's a problem, potential problem
Wait.
With adopting the tax rate on the 30th, 31st. So.
Chair Chair recognizes Mr. Delgado.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Mr. Vela, just a quick point on with regards to the insurances. I know you, last time you had mentioned that we were on a 3-year agreement with those companies. Mm-hmm. After that, we can go out for quotes, bids, and
yes,
see.
Yes, actually, I'm sorry.
No, I'm good. Go ahead.
Actually, the agreement that we have is with USI out of El Paso, and actually they're a brokerage and a consulting firm. So okay. They're the ones working on behalf on getting us the quotes, and that's the agreement that we have with them. So yes, but to answer your question, yes, once that agreement is over, then we can go out again to
something cheaper, please.
Chair recognizes Mrs. Vela.
Yes, me? Yes. Okay, thank you. Going back to what you all were discussing, I know that we do have to approve the budget before the first, but if we would consider giving a bonus like the, you know, could we get it out of our fund balance as a one-time thing? Because, I'm just, you know.
If it is a one-time.
It would be a one-time thing.
If it's a one-time expenditure, yes.
We could do it from
if
there.
It's an addition to the salary of the employees, then that becomes an operational
but
cost.
Would it, Rusty, would it be considered as part of the contract? No, not if it was a one-time bonus that we give.
No, that is correct. And I don't think that employees
balance.
Will sign contracts prior to September 1. So, I mean, if you, and I don't know what the financial issues are, but.
That would be something that we could consider after we approve the budget, you know, is used as some of the fund balance. Because I noticed the amount and it's not a drastic amount. And it's like not a million.
It's something that the board could take a look at,
you
know, even next week.
Yeah.
We can discuss it later.
Yeah, that's something we can discuss. We have a.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Any other questions, concerns? Okay. Ms. Vela? I'm sorry.
No, that's it. I'm finished.
I'm sorry. Chair recognizes Mrs. Ramos.
So I move that the Laredo College Board of Trustees approve and adopt the resolution which adopts the fiscal year 2022 budget. Is that correct, or do I still have to read the resolution?
Yes, one more.
Okay.
Yeah, one more. I'm sorry.
Okay. There's two steps to the adoption of the budget.
Okay.
The first one is to read the resolution that's included in your packet, and then the second step is to make a motion to approve and adopt the resolution.
This one?
No, resolution adopting the budget for fiscal year 22?
That's correct.
Okay.
So this is that. And then there's two more, right?
Mr. Muir.
Mr. Muir. Chair recognizes Mr. Muir.
Thank you. There was a resolution included in the board packet,
yes.
And that has been slightly modified. I do have the modified version here just to ensure that we're reading the correct one. If you'd like, I could read it for you.
Mr. Muir, is it the one that says revised?
They all say revised.
It was revised again.
Yes.
It was revised again.
That should be it. Correct.
Okay. Can you go ahead and read it for
us?
Yes,
please.
Uh-huh. I'd be happy to.
Mr. Muir?
Let's see which one.
Resolution adopting budget for fiscal year 2022. Whereas each year, the Board of Trustees of Laredo College District is required to have a budget prepared showing the estimated revenue and proposed expenditures for the succeeding school year, and to cause the same to be filed in accordance with the rules and regulations prescribed by the Texas Higher Education Board. And whereas such a budget has been prepared and the public has been given notice that such budget would be presented for discussion and adoption on August 26, 2021, at the time and place specified in such notice. And whereas such budget has been discussed and a majority of the Board of Trustees wish to adopt same for fiscal year 2022. Be it resolved, therefore, that such budget be adopted and same is hereby adopted in all things, adopted this 26th day of August 2021 by the Board of Trustees.
I second.
So move, Madam Chair.
So I have a motion.
I'll second.
By Ms. Mares, and I have a second by Mr. Delgado. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Aye.
Ms. Elizondo opposes the fiscal year 2022. Motion carries. The second one is the 982, no, I'm sorry, 981, right?
982.
So, Mr. Muir, will you read that one again?
I can, and if I may, the adoption of a tax rate, there are some rules under the tax code that have special requirements for wording that has to be included in resolutions and wording that has to be included in motions. So what I'd like to do, if it's okay with the board, is to read the resolution adopting the tax rate for fiscal year 2022. That would be the 2021 tax rate. And then there is motion that has particular language, and I think one of the trustees could read that after I read the resolution.
Okay, so Mr. Muir, will you read the resolution?
Yes, I will. Resolution of Laredo College District Board of Trustees adopting tax rate for fiscal year 2022. Whereas the Board of Trustees of Laredo College District, in order to levy ad valorem taxes, is required to set and establish a tax rate each year. And whereas such Board of Trustees has considered this matter and desires to set the 2021 property tax rate. Be it resolved, therefore, that on August 26, 2021, the 2021 property tax rate be, and the same is hereby set at, 0.319441 per $100 valuation of taxable property, of which 0.252022 shall be for maintenance and operations, and 0.067419 shall be for debt retirement. This tax rate will raise more taxes for maintenance and operation than last year's tax rate. The tax rate will effectively be raised by 8% and will raise taxes for maintenance and operations on a $100,000 home by approximately negative 84 cents. Such taxes are to be assessed and collected by the tax officials designated by Laredo College, adopted this 26th day of August 2021 by the Board of Trustees. And that's the end of the motion, Madam Chair.
So I have, Chair recognizes Mrs. Pardon. Ramos.
Mm-hmm. So now I read the motion, right?
That's right.
Okay. So I move that the property tax rate be increased by the adoption of a tax rate of 0.319441 per $100 valuation of taxable property, of which 0.252022 shall be for maintenance and operations, and 0.067419 shall be for debt retirement, which is effectively a 6.45% increase in the tax rate, and that the Board of Trustees approve and adopt the resolution which adopts the 2021 property tax rate. That's my motion.
So I have a motion by Mrs. Ramos. I have a second by Mr. Delgado. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
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 Any opposed?
Hi, just for the record, I'm again raising taxes.
Okay. So Ms. Elizondo opposes. So the majority rules. So
wait.
Motion carries.
Rusty.
Oh. Chair recognizes Mr. Muir.
If I may, I'm not sure if, because I know we have one trustee that's appearing by telephone. I don't know if he voted and if his vote was recognized.
I'm for.
Okay.
He's for board.
Just to be sure, so we have that
on
the record.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yes.
So motion passes. The next one is 983, resolution authorizing collection of general use fee and expenditures of funds for fiscal year 2022. So that's also a resolution that needs to be read.
That is correct.
Mr. Muir?
Yes.
Madam Chair, just a question. Can we have discussion, or do we need to read the resolution first and then discussion?
And then discussion.
Yeah.
That is correct.
Thank you.
Mr. Muir?
Yes, so resolution authorizing collection of general use fee and expenditure funds for fiscal year 2022. Whereas the Board of Trustees of the Laredo College District is authorized to fix and collect tuition and fees from students for the use of its property, buildings, and facilities. facilities, and to apply such proceeds to the payment of principal and interest of certain revenue bonds issued and sold in 2011, 2015, 2016, 2017, and 2020 for expenses generally associated with construction, reconstruction, remodeling, and repair of its property, buildings, and facilities. Whereas such Board of Trustees has determined that such general use fee should be set at $50 per semester credit hour for fiscal year 2021 and be used as follows: approximately $4,218,270 for revenue bond debt service, approximately $500,000 to be retained as general revenue for expenses related to physical plant operations and maintenance, the balance for payment of construction, reconstruction, remodeling, and repair of property, buildings, and facilities. Be it resolved, therefore, that a general use fee be collected from students at the time of registration in the amount of $50 per semester credit hour for fiscal year 2022, adopted on this 26th day of August 2021 by the Board of Trustees.
Thank you. Chair recognizes Mrs. Ramos.
So I move that the Laredo College Board of Trustees approve and adopt the resolution authorizing the collection of a general use fee and expenditure of funds for fiscal year 2022.
Second.
And I have a second by Mr. Delgado. Discussion. Yes. Chair recognizes Ms. Elizondo.
Mr. Delgado, it's actually a question.
Yes,
so we are removing $50 per semester credit hour from students.
We're charging $50 per semester credit hour for that fee.
Okay, is there any way that we can pull money from somewhere else as opposed to giving this way to our current or to our students?
Again, these fees were set to cover the expenditure of the bonds. We have a couple of revenue bonds that are listed there, 2011 through 2020. And that fee is set aside for that purpose. Again, until we finish paying off the bonds, it'll be a recurring expenditure. So for us to pull and say, okay, well, let's use reserve to pay, we're not gonna have the money to pay off the bonds. So that money, unfortunately, needs to be charged.
Any other discussion? Yes, Chair recognizes Ms. Ramos.
Mr. Vela,
yes,
the general use fee has been placed before on the table, no? When you do tuition, general use fee, and then the rest of the other fees, right? Mm-hmm. So is it part of the collection of the tuition and fees?
It is part of the tuition and fee that is charged at the college, yes.
So it's already in place, but you're adopting it, you were asking for this year, correct?
Yes, it's authorizing us a collection to pay off the bonds. It's a resolution, but again, the fee's already set. So, but let's say, for example, if that fee were to increase, then it would require board approval.
Correct,
yes.
But what I'm trying to clarify is that in the table where when I come to register for classes here,
yes,
the general use fee is already in place right now, correct?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
It's part of your bill, yes.
I just want to make sure.
Yes.
Okay.
Chair recognizes Ms. Elizondo.
Is this the actual balance that we owe?
That's the annual payment. $1.2 million.
So you don't foresee this amount going away anytime soon?
The bonds that we have, our 20-year bonds.
Yeah.
So we're paying them off as we go.
2014.
Now that amount, the $4.2 million, eventually will start decreasing as those bonds get paid off.
Yeah.
Not all of the bonds are going to be paid off in 20 years. Some of them are going to be earlier.
No.
So you'll start seeing that mm-hmm. payment go down.
Right. And I understand, but I still have a concern, even though with the incentive that administration put in place of lowering tuition free tuition, yet students were still responsible for paying fees, and it's still, fees are extremely high, and I understand that we need to operate, but at the same time, there are other ways of funding, and we need to be more creative, because we cannot be depending on students to pay debt. So I just want to make sure, como, that we are more creative and see where can we possibly look into reducing student fees. Because $50 here, $75 here, $25 here, like it adds a plus tuition. So we need to do something.
Chair recognizes, are you finished?
Yes, it was just a notation.
Chair recognizes Judge Martinez.
Thank you, Madam Chair. The media through Laredo College advertised or had an article that we are charging tuition-free, so to speak, to the students, correct?
Correct.
We're waiving the tuition, yes.
Waiving the tuition. However, over and above that, now we're also charging, we're adding a $50 per credit per semester hour, correct?
Judge, no, this fee was already part of the total structure. Yes, it's always been there. Yes.
So it goes with the freebie.
Yes, yes, it's always been there.
So that's the example.
I got a lot of complaints from students.
Thank you.
It's not.
I just have a comment. If you look at your water bill, look at all the additional fees on your water bill. That's a perfect example. But that's my comment.
I know, but water, it's an actual need.
Just so you know, may I?
Yes. Chair recognizes Dr. Carranza.
I think that what Ms. Alessandro is saying is correct. We have to be careful where we pick the money from. We cannot be picking just from the students. It's easy. That's the easiest plug you can get. But you have to look at other areas that you need to cut. There are certain things that have fat, and we have to trim the fat a little bit. Whether they like it or not, we have to protect the student too. You know, there's plenty of fat out there. You know, I'm sure you can shave a little here and a little there.
And we have, again, for the debt that we have for those bonds, it's not all paid by the students. A portion or a big portion of it is being paid by the taxpayer. Again, there's a six cent, the 31 cent tax includes 6 cents that are going for the debt service. Now, as far as making cuts, we have been working on making cuts. Last year we cut down $3 million. This year, the initial budget request came in $6 million higher than the previous year. So we cut back again and were able to adjust it down to a $3 million increase.
Good.
Yeah.
Chair recognizes Dr. Tijerina.
Dr. Tijerina, interim president for the record, I wanna bring information to the board that we have not raised tuition and fees since the student activity fee to bring athletics, which was in 2013. So since 2013, we have not raised tuition and fees. And for clarification, as Mr. Vela said, we're not increasing any fees. This fee is going to pay the bond that's mentioned here. So just for point of clarification, that we have not increased tuition and fees for a long time.
I'm gonna call for the vote.
Can I be recognized?
Chair recognizes Ms. Elizondo.
Mr. Vela, just for clarification purposes, so we can illustrate to the board, on an average student that it's taking four courses, how many, more or less, how many fees do they take? 12 hours.
So we're talking 12 hours. I believe that the bill is...
without including tuition.
Let me defer to Dr. Solis.
Fred Solis, Vice President for Student Success and Enrollment. Ms. Elizondo, that would be $1,650, without applying the tuition discount that we currently have in place.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. But that includes tuition and fees, right? Yeah, tuition and fees, okay.
Chair recognizes Mrs. Ramos.
I just wanna make a clarification. So we have 90% of our students in financial aid here. More than 90% of our students receive financial aid. But can you review or go back to what we talked about last week? And you also mentioned the number of the monies that come in as far as financial aid, because that's part of the package of the whole entire budget, but it is not something that we utilize to be able to pay, let's say, our debt or anything else, but it's more than anything. That amount of money that you talked about last week, it was what is geared towards the students. If the students fill out their financial aid form, the FAFSA, even if they don't qualify for financial aid from the government, they still should apply for the financial, the FAFSA, so that they can get either state or local assistance. So can you, do you have the numbers with you? I mean, I don't have them with me right now, but I don't know if they're in the booklet. I just wanted to clarify that.
We do have federal funding, Pell.
Yes.
And that, again, I don't have the amounts, I guess, in an average by student, but annually we receive around 19 million for student aid, and that is Pell grants, and that goes to the student, and that covers their tuition and fees and their books. In addition to that, this last fiscal year in this, we received the CARES Act funding. And there were two components to it. One was for emergency aid to the student, and that went directly to the student. And the other component, which is part of our budget, we're using $4.2 million to cover the tuition waiver. So again, right now, looking at the fall semester, and I know Dr. Solis has a has an update on the on the on enrollment, but we developed the budget that just got approved. We estimated that we were going to have 48,000 semester credit hours for the fall semester. Right now, you'll see that we actually have exceeded that projection right now for the fall semester. So when we look at the number, we're talking about close to about $2.7 million that we're waiving in tuition to those students. So yes, the tuition component, which is the $50 per semester credit hour, they're not paying that. They are paying the fees, which, like Dr. Solis mentioned, when you look at the total 12 hours, it's $1,650. If you look at the $50, that's $600 just in tuition, so they're paying around $1,000.
And also, we offer emergency loans and a payment plan. Those are the different options that are available in addition to if a student receives financial aid.
That's
so
correct.
If the student comes in and is unable to pay the $1,650, they offer them emergency tuition loans, correct, Dr. Fred? Yes? I just want to make this clarification because it's really important for us to understand the entire process of what the budget and the funding and everything that goes into it.
Right. Fred Solis, Vice President for Student Success and Enrollment. The answer to your question is correct. When the student makes the commitment to attend Laredo College, federal Pell is probably the first option that a student exercises to pay for their bill. However, although 90% of our students do qualify for this federal aid, if they've been with us for a while, they tend to disqualify themselves due to their academic performance.
Correct.
So when that happens, then the student no longer is eligible for federal aid, but that's when the local aid and the state aid kicks in. And so there's private donor monies, there's scholarships that are available, and the like. And so really, if the commitment is there, there are opportunities and options that the student can seek and that we make available for them.
Thank you, Doctor. Thank you, Madam Chair.
So I call for the vote. Oh, yes, Dr. Tijerina.
I just want to inform the board too that part of the reason why we get number one community college in Texas is because we do offer the lowest debt to our students. So to answer your concern is that we provide the lowest debt opportunities for our students.
Thank you, Dr. Tijerina. That's our call for the vote. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Aye.
Show on the record, Ms. Elizondo opposed. Mr. Rangel?
I am also opposed.
Okay, so show Mr. Rangel opposed. So that will leave me
2-7.
Okay. Yeah. So motion carries. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Rangel.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much.
The next item is Chair recognizes Mr. Delgado.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Madam Chair, I motion to go into executive session and move items 9B as well as executive session items 11A, 11B, 11C into executive session.
So I have a motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
Mm-hmm. I have a second by Ms. Maris. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. So I'm just going to read the executive session at this time. I'm going to recommend we go into executive session. The time is now 7:45 p.m., and the board will adjourn into executive session pursuant to sections 551.071 and 551.074 of the Texas Government Code to discuss agenda items 9B, 11A, 11B, and 11C. Did you have a question, Mr. Muir?
Yes. There are different section of the government code for each item. And if I may, I can clarify that.
Thank you.
Section item 11A, which is a closed discussion for legal advice regarding the building lease agreement between the Imaginarium of South Texas and the college, that's section 551.071. Now, the discussion about rescinding acceptance of real property donated to Laredo College, that's item 11B. The sections are 551.071, 551.072, and 551.073. For item 11C, that involves the safety and security audit per TEC 37.108C. Those sections of the Open Meetings Act are 551.071 and 551.076. The fourth item that's made part of the motion to go into executive session is item 9B, and that addresses the discussion and possible action on the coves at Winfield Tax Increment Reinvestment Zone. The section for that would be 551.071 to receive legal advice, and the law does require that we cite those sections before heading into executive session.
Mr. Rangel, are you with us?
Hello.
Guess not.
It is.
Hello?
Yeah, you're with us. Put it on mute.
I'm here.
Okay.
We're reconvened from executive session. The time is 8:52, and the board took no action in executive session. We'll take appropriate action on items if necessary as discussed in closed session. The next item we have is 9B, discussion and possible action on the coves at Winfield Tax Increment Reinvestment Zone, TIRS number 2, Dr. Maricela Rodriguez Tijerina.
Yes, Dr. Tijerina, for the record, we have Dr. Rolando Ortiz, who's here to either conduct a presentation or be open to questions that the board members may have.
Thank you. Welcome, Dr. Ortiz.
Good evening, Madam Chair, trustees, Madam Interim President. Dr. Rolando Ortiz for the record. I'm the Chief Operating Officer for Killam Development. We have Myron Dornick with Jackson Walker, who's our attorney. And I'm not sure how you'd like me to proceed. I do think I have a presentation here. If I can, let's see if I can. Oops. There we go. So we're excited to be in front of you today to ask for your approval on the new participation rate, which lowers the college participation on the TIRS to 40%. It brings the Killam great pride to help Laredo College realize the goal of having a presence in North Laredo. This facility can be a home for several things. I know there's been some question as to what might go in there. Even back in 2017, there might have been a purpose. But today, I mean, there's things that like Cyber Ranges or a diabetic center that is sorely needed in Laredo, where we can train our youth in that campus, right? So there are several things we can do with the school that's there. We all know the Killam family through their philanthropic activities. They've helped thousands of Laredoans towards higher education. This is just one more example. We're also proud to help facilitate this public-private partnership. We will include the City of Laredo, the County of Webb, Laredo College, and the Killam family. What better way to say Laredo, Texas is open for business with a true collaboration that will infuse private capital, investment, partnerships, job creation, all to increase our tax base. In the past few months, we have been before you several times. We've gone to a couple of committee meetings, which we appreciate, and we've discussed this item quite a bit. Let me dive into the presentation. As we all know, this TERS was created by city ordinance in 2017 and is an active TERS zone. If it pleases Madam Chair, I can kind of go through some of the slides that we've already relatively quickly.
Sure.
The Coves is going to be a little over 1,000 acres. This tax increment zone is estimated to create 2,000 jobs over the 30-year period. It's a long-term finance mechanism that will help sustain development for many years to come. It's a good way to plan your tax base. I think that one of the questions was asked at the last board meeting. We actually made a presentation to the full board, was how much is that total investment for vertical development? Homes, townhomes, commercial properties, those types of things. It's going to be over $728,000. We've gone through the key points of this TERS, which you have a little over 1,000 acres again. The county is going to receive 4 acres for a fire station. The Laredo North campus will be 1.8 acres, over 1,700 single family homes, 900 apartment units, and so on, a little 650,000 square foot of retail, and about 100 hotel units.
This gives and the amount, Dr. Ortiz, it's million, right?
Million, did I say 1,000?
You said 1,000.
Million, sorry. Sometimes I can't count. It's getting late for me. I'm usually in bed.
Past your bedtime.
I appreciate your all's patience because it is a labor of love. This is a little example of the coving design that we have. And they're irregular lots. It's designed to help the environment. We're trying to keep as much natural vegetation as possible in this area. So we're excited about that. The project costs, you have the Laredo College building at $1.6 million. The total infrastructure cost is $72 million. That's a capital infusion from the private sector, which would be us. And the other amenities, 3.5, which will include bike trails, amenities in the town center that we're looking to create. On the financing part of it, the zone is gonna have a $10.5 million base this year. And I'll get into that a little further down. All the entities will be participating with 40% of the tax increment, plus some of the rollbacks. And you can see everybody is participating at the same rate. Again, the comparison from 2017 to 2021, the term was 30 years. It will continue to be 30 years. Again, the participation rate is going down from 60% to 40%. The base value was $9.7 million. It's now $10.5 million over the past few years that it's increased. And this is important. The M&O collected revenue for the college was 15.2. Now with a different participation rate, it's gonna be $28.6 million. The Laredo College building will have that 1.8 acres with a 6,500 square foot facility. We're projecting the TERS base value at the end, the ad valorem value at the end of the 30 years to be a little over $1 billion. For example, if the property sits the way it is today, it'll increase to close to 71 million. This shows the total revenue that will be received, estimated to be received by the college is a little over $41 million. This includes the sinking fund that will go help pay current debt that the college owns. And here, you won't have to incur any debt. Again, the benefits to the college is at the end of the 30-year term, there'll be $1 billion worth of ad valorem, and plus there'll be a North Laredo campus. Again, the financing is 40% from all the different entities that are participating in the collaboration, and the community college will receive 60% of the M&O, as well as the debt service sinking fund revenue. This is really truly the developer has to make this deal happen in order for the increment to increase. It's performance based. So if there's nothing that goes vertical, nothing that gets created, there is no reimbursement, right? So it is a good way to have the developer inject the capital so we can receive the reimbursement through the tax increment zone. Again, we talked about this where the Laredo campus is gonna end up, would be off of Inspiration Drive, which is the main road coming in off of Loop 20. It's again on 1.8 acres. The 6,500 square foot facility would be built, and there's still some room for expansion. Now, this is all on paper, right? There'll be collaboration. The college will have to talk to find out and see exactly what you all want. Maybe you want one building, a little bigger or what have you, so we can work on that. And then you can also tell us when you need it. This is just a rendering that we've had drawn up. It could look like this. And again, I'm sure there'll be several iterations of what this facility would look like. This is a 30-acre town center. We're looking to create a mixed-use development. Oh, thank you. And so typically I don't need a microphone, it's a mixed-use development. We're encouraging. We're following the Viva Laredo comprehensive plan that is asking to mix the uses with townhomes, single family, some commercial, and this institution of higher education. This kind of gives you a little bit of an idea of what the town center would feel and look like. It's a bird's eye view of what we're looking at. You can see where some of the single family homes are, the townhomes, and then some of the commercial facilities would be. What we're asking for today is to get approval on the contribution plan, which is really kind of amending the resolution that was passed back in 2017 with a 60% participation rate and decreasing it to 40%, which again is better for the college. And if you all could also appoint a college representative to the TERS board. And we've spoken with Mr. Muir, and if you have anything, Rusty?
No, I did speak with, and if I may be recognized, Madam Chair.
Chair recognizes Mr. Muir.
Yeah, we did visit on a few occasions with Dr. Ortiz and also Killam's attorney, Mr. Myron Dominic, and including today, and we went over this action that it's being asked of the board, which would be to agree to the contribution plan. That would be a 40% contribution from the Laredo College tax revenues based on the increment over the life of the TURF. So I'm not sure if any board member has questions of me or of Dr. Ortiz. I'd be happy to try and answer what I could.
Chair recognizes Mrs. Ramos.
Dr. Ortiz, the extent of the TERS is 30 years.
Yes, ma'am.
Is that negotiable?
It is standard to have a 30-year term. If you look at our finance plan, over that 30 years is basically when the reimbursement will fully occur. Sometimes these overperform, so it could be shorter. And so once the amount is paid back, the TERS terminates, right? But you give it enough runway, which is 30 years typically, to satisfy that capital injection.
I have one more question.
Go ahead.
My other question is, I understand there's three entities, correct?
Yes, ma'am.
So it is the city, the county, and the college.
That's correct.
So I know it's a step plan. So you come to us first, we make the decision, and then the other two entities decide. Can we, because one of your slides, it's the city, the county, and then us. But it seems to be that we're the first to make the decision. So is there any way that we could, you know, kind of sort of be go like last. Right?
So yeah, so and again, last time, you know, we came to you all, we went to the county, and then we went to the city. The zone passed, right? And so it still will come back to you, right? Once the development plan is approved by the actual board of the TERS board, it actually goes back to the city, and then the city approves that, what they call the finance plan and the development plan, and then we come back to you for the final approval as well. So there are a few more steps, and without this approval tonight, we can't get back to the city, in particular without having a board member for the TERS.
So
go ahead.
So it is contingent on creating that board that's going to essentially go to the other individuals. Have they already appointed somebody without let's say voting for the TERS, or they already voted for the TERS?
No. So the TERS is already created. The mm-hmm. zone is already created, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. So the county has reappointed Lalo Uribe mm-hmm. as their representative. The city will now, hopefully on September 7th, will have their board meeting to approve the amended ordinance, right? Mm-hmm. So that's changed from the developer initiating the TERS with 12 board members to the city's gonna do it with only 5 board members now. And so at that meeting, they'll appoint their 3 board members, approve the amended ordinance, and it has to be read twice, and they'll also approve the finance plan and the development agreement preliminary. Then it goes to the TERS board to get them to approve the finance plan, the development agreement, mm-hmm. and so once they do that, then it'll go back to the city for final approval.
So it is contingent on us either saying yes and then appointing a board member to serve on it.
That is correct.
Correct. So that's the way the process works.
That is correct.
Is there any way that that you could appoint a board member without approving, like the city is waiting to approve, or the county has already approved? You told me the county has not approved yet, but they have appointed somebody to serve on the board, correct? Right.
So the county is kind of in the same situation as you all are, right?
Mm-hmm.
They've already approved a 60-40 split, right? So the city had approved that too on the preliminary finance plan.
Mm-hmm.
So in these negotiations that started in September, that split went from 60 to 40. Mm-hmm. Again, which got better for all the entities, right? And you know, we listened to the city. They were like, hey, we need, because they have cost of services. They got police, fire, water, I mean, street maintenance, those types of things. So we understood that. We said, okay, well, we'll do 40%. And we figured we'd be able to come back to this body and say, it's not 60 anymore, it's gonna be 40, because it's better if everybody participates at the same rate, right?
Mm-hmm.
So that's why we're here today, trying to get that accomplished. And if the commitment isn't there from the college, the deal doesn't work.
For everybody.
For everybody.
Last question.
Yes, ma'am.
I'm sorry. Yeah. Only question.
No, that's all right.
I had it in my mind. Not is it negotiable on the building?
With
is the
regards
building,
to?
The building negotiable. And we talked a little bit about, you know, in the workshops and stuff. So more or less, or more, or different uses of it. I mean, coming back, if the voting is gonna take place to participate in the TERS, coming back, we're gonna have to come back and have that conversation with the board, with the TERS board, if it passes, and also discuss what the uses of the building are going to be. That's another process in itself that's gonna happen, but is that negotiable?
Now, negotiable by, what do you mean by negotiable?
A bigger building or other areas or you?
Yeah, so we're committed to providing $1.6 million for the facility.
Mm-hmm.
That will get you about a 6,500 square foot building. When you want that built is up to you all. But that is kind of the deal. And that will be in the actual development plan that is agreed to, that the TERS board will approve, if that makes any sense.
Okay.
Chair recognizes Mr. Delgado.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Thank you, Dr. Ortiz, for that presentation once again. Question, you've mentioned the TERS number one has been mentioned several times.
Number two.
Well, you've mentioned number one as far as the 60-40 split that was already approved. And just for clarification.
Oh, well, it was still number two.
Well, I know, but the one that was approved back in 2016, because I think
the original TERS number
correct.
Two. Okay.
That one is non-existent anymore, correct?
No, it's still in place.
So, for this number two, this is just an added layer, or this is just a replacement or an amendment?
So,
to the
maybe
first one?
Myron can explain it a little better, but
yeah.
Go ahead.
Yeah.
You brought the big guns.
Yeah.
Yeah. Madam Chair, members of the board, Myron Dornick. The TERS was adopted by the city and it is in place, but it has not been collecting increment. It's the same TERS that this board and the county had a resolution for 60%. Now we're just reducing that amount. What the TERS needs to do is they need to create a final project and financing plan. And that's what the city's working on. And in order to create this document, they need to have some assurance of what the contributions are going to be. So that's why we're asking you to preliminarily say that 40% seems acceptable to you as long as we work out the details on the building and you get to see that final project and financing plan before you actually sign an agreement saying you're giving your 40%.
So this is this decision to be made if and when is to amend the TERS, the first TERS. This is not an added layer to the first one that was agreed to in 2016.
No, it's not an add-on. It is basically saying
to change.
The change is going to be, we're not going to contribute at 60% whenever the project and financing plan is done, it's going to be 40%.
Gotcha. Okay.
And plus some the rollback taxes. So there would be 100% of the rollback taxes plus 40% of the M&O increment only.
Gotcha. So this is TERS number one, part two, essentially.
TERS, no, well, TERS number one is the city's downtown TERS. So this is TERS number two. Gotcha.
Now, on that note that you mentioned about the building, you mentioned it's, the, I don't want to misspeak, but you said $1.6 million for the North Campus building. What exactly does that include? Is that just the shell of the building itself included with the finish out?
Yeah, it's a couple of $100 a square foot. The idea is to build the facility with restrooms, offices, classrooms, mm-hmm. what have you, yeah.
Okay. Now, I guess this is for administration and for my colleagues, but what is the plan for the building? What are we going to do with that? Because I understand and we're definitely grateful to be considered for this, yeah. but I think moving forward, especially with the situation that we're in, not only financially, but also enrollment-wise, is considering the fact that such a large, beautiful building that would be constructed, we would have to take care of the M&O on that. We'd have to fill it up. We'd have to figure out how exactly we're going to utilize that and what exactly is that going to do to our budget. I know there's going to be added dollars that are going to go into it with regards to the 60% that we're going to collect, but how much of that are we going to be able to afford if our enrollment continues to decline? But that's all. Thank you.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
But Dr. Tejerina wanted to speak.
Chair recognizes Dr. Tejerina.
Dr. Tejerina, for the record, currently we don't have an answer to present as far as what the building could become. There's a lot of brainstorming that has been discussed from an economic development center to potentially a bachelor's degree building. But again, there's also the concern with the enrollment not where it needs to be, and close to 40% of our population is dual enrollment. And right now, it's hard with the whole COVID situation. Our students primarily wanted online digital learning, so it's hard to answer that question, but certainly we are brainstorming in should it move forward, you know, on what to do. But of course, the finances are a concern.
Thank you. Chair recognizes Ms. Elizondo.
Just for the record, Dr. Rodriguez, I have a question. Prior to COVID, has there been any discussion pertaining any future buildings in North Laredo? As we all are aware, we have two campuses, South and the main campus, this campus. Has any discussion been made in possible buildings in the North area besides this proposed plan?
Dr. Tejerina, for the record, we have discussed several. This is one of them. We had also talked about potentially using some rooms in the UT Health Science Center in the Laredo expansion right by LMC. So to answer your question, yes, there's been ideas thrown out, but nothing
concrete,
exactly.
Chair recognizes Ms. Mares.
Thank you, Madam Chair, and thank you, Dr. Ortiz and sir, for your presentation. I think that having heard some of this discussion, Madam Chair, I feel personally that maybe we should work on some more dialogue and more discussion with, you know, the Killams to answer some of these questions that are still, you know, looming or lingering over, you know, what we're going to do if we move forward with them. So. I don't know if I'm in order or not, but I would like to make a motion to defer this item to our next meeting so that offering that interim time for you, Madam Chair, the officers or the administration to sit at the table and with Mr. Muir possibly at the table one more time with the Killams and you know, iron out some of these little details or even look into, you know, more possibilities and then come back to this board so that we can take a firmer action one way or the other.
So I have a motion for Ms. Mares. Do I hear a second? I have a second from Mrs. Vela. Any discussion?
Yeah,
Chair recognizes Judge Martinez.
Judge Martinez.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I do feel very strongly about this TERS, and I do feel very strongly that Laredo College needs to have presence. And obviously, that development that you have is obviously going to be a tremendous asset. As has been discussed already, perhaps you might be able to get together with Dr. Tijerina. I know that you did get together with Dr. Solis prior to the time that he actually resigned. And but maybe perhaps at this time it would be possible to meet with Dr. Tijerina and then also with Dr. Tijerina to bring in some of the other administrative staff that can you can address this one issue, okay? And once they are more aware, more knowledgeable about it, I certainly feel that we can bring it up again. I do support it. I'm not saying I'm a but perhaps right now, because there seems to be some need for additional detail and additional background, if you don't mind, as the motion has already been made by and seconded by members of the board to defer this, and then between now and whenever it is that we bring it up again, following up during that interim period, you might be able to meet with Dr. Tijerina and her administrative staff. Would that be okay with you, sir?
We'd be more than happy to.
Great. Okay.
Chair recognizes Mrs. Ramos.
Thank you, Madam Chair. And Dr. Ortiz, I think what I do want to explain, because it's already late, but more than anything, I think it's answering some other questions that some of the board members might have. Some concerns, some issues. For the record, I feel that, you know, I'm in support also as well, but right now at the moment, I still have some questions that I'd like to get clarification. And I know that you have a timeline to follow. We too have a timeline to follow as far as like making the decision and not prolonging it for a much later time. So when would be, and you could meet with the chair of the board and the president of the interim president of the college, so that we can have a little bit more clarification. And I think the dialogue is really important when it comes to these things. And it goes back to the first question that I had. 30 years is a long time, right?
Sure.
So 30 years to me is, I personally don't know if I'm gonna be here 30 years from now, I hope so. But still, I would like to say, should happen, I would like to say I was there, and you know, we planned correctly, we talked, we dialogued, and we discussed, and we did the right thing, and we moved forward, right? So I hope you understand from that perspective, but I think the dialogue needs to continue for the time being. So with that said, I do appreciate your presentation.
No, absolutely, Madam Chair, if I may.
Yes.
So, one of the things we've, as the Killam organization, is the actual TERS tool being used in Laredo, Texas, which is, there's a partial one, or there's one for the downtown area, but in order to help a city grow, and so we could have students to enroll into the colleges and use our facilities in Laredo, these tools work. And I have to tell you, I see what's happened in the Valley, and the first tours there was done in 2020. The entities that participated at 100%. They're gonna wake up in 11 years, and they're gonna see their tax value go from $58 million in 2000 to probably close to $800 million in 11 years. And then that tax increment just boom. And so I would just like for you all to keep that in mind too, as far as economic development for our community.
Yeah, I've worked on many TERSs throughout the state, and the participation rate here is very low, and that's why it's 30 years. If it was a higher participation rate, then the term would, you know, the term would be shorter.
And just so Dr. Ortiz said, the Valley is 11 years.
Mm-hmm. It started in 2000, so it'll end.
Oh, you said 2020.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I meant 2000, sorry.
Okay.
So yeah, it started in 2000 and it'll end in 2031, 2030.
Any other discussion?
Call for the vote.
Mm-hmm. Madam Chair, just one last comment. Just want to thank you for your consideration. Thank you for having the North in mind. Most of my constituents reside in those areas, and I think it's very important that we keep North Laredo, like, and I echo Judge Martinez's words. Thank you for having that in mind, and I just want to appreciate it.
Thank you.
So Chair recognizes Ms. Elizondo, but she already said her comments. So I'm going to call for the vote. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
So I have how many for favor?
So
one, two, three, four, five. Uh-huh. Five to defer?
Yes.
Five to defer? Any against? So I have Ms. Elizondo and the judge, so I have two. So motion passes to defer. So we'll have our...
I'll get a hold of
Dr. Tejerina and...
We'll set up a meeting for next
week. Set up a meeting to discuss further.
Thank you,
Dr. Ortiz. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Next item we have is 9C, discussion and consideration to include the following projects to the Laredo College Facilities Master Plan Phase 3 bond construction projects. Mr. Cesar Vela.
Good evening. For the record, Cesar Vela, Vice President of Finance. This next item, Madam President, members of the board, is to request approval to add the following projects to the Facilities Master Plan Phase 3 bond construction. The first one is the Martinez Fine Arts Center HVAC improvements. We have currently reached end of life on the HVAC system at the MFA. The MFA is serviced by a standalone chiller at the MFA. That project is projected to cost $2 million, and that is just the base project, and it entails in replacing existing trained water chillers, and those are two 125-ton chillers, replacing VAV boxes, and also upgrading the controls in that building. Now, part of this project also, right now on the agenda, there was an item that was approved as consent, and that was a study to be conducted by Train to explore two other options for this particular building. One of the options is to have a central plant on the north side of campus with a thermal tank storage to service the Martinez Fine Arts Center, the VPA, and the LEAC buildings. Again, that option would cost an additional $4 million, so we would be looking at about $6 million for that project. And the third option that we have is to do the prep work without the thermal storage tank, and that would be about $4.5 million total project. But again, right now what we're asking is that the board approve adding the MFA at $2 million, and this is just to do the replacement of the HVAC equipment. Again, this is just a base project. It is something that needs to be done.
Chair recognizes Mr. Delgado.
And I'm sorry, Mr. Delgado, I don't mean to interrupt, but were these the ones that were discussed in committee?
Yes, sir, the building committee.
Okay.
Yes, and the second project is the Lamar Bruni Vergara Environmental Center. And again, we've identified that this particular facility needs some repairs and upgrades, specifically to the animal enclosures, the shade structures. We do have a small classroom that is utilized by the science department. So there's a request to upgrade some of the technology and also expand a little bit on that classroom. And also there are some HVAC needs for the area, for the center. And the right now, the estimate that we have for that project is $1.5 million. So part of the, again, part of the approval that we're requesting is to add those two projects to the facilities master plan. And the second component is to approve redistributing $2 million of phase three bond money that had previously been allocated to the Ruben Garcia building project. Now this building, this project, again, we do have $1.4 million that are allocated for the Lopez Nursing Building as part of the phase two project bond. We feel that the $1.4 million can cover both the Lopez and the Ruben Garcia building based on the scope of work that needs to be done at that building. So again, that would free up the $2 million to address the MFA HVAC project.
Okay. Chair recognizes Judge.
Did you have something to say? I move that we approve the recommendation of Mr. Vela.
Second.
So I have a motion by Judge Martinez. I have a second by Mr. Delgado. Any discussion? None heard. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries.
Thank you.
Chair recognizes Mr. Delgado.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Madam Chair, I motion to move up agenda item 12A, discussion and possible action for approval of building lease agreement between the Imaginarium of South Texas and Laredo College.
I second. So I have a motion by Mr. Delgado. I have a second by Mrs. Ramos. Any discussion? None heard. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. So discussion and
can I motion? Oh.
Yes. So we have a representative from the Imaginarium, is that correct?
Yes.
Mr. Perez?
Yes.
Welcome, Mr. Perez. Always.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Very happy. I'm the Assistant Superintendent for Technology for UIC, and I'm the Board President for the Imaginarium. I just want to thank you on behalf of all the children, on behalf of your future students, for what you did tonight. Thank you very much. What you did is you saved the Imaginarium, because if we had not had an opportunity to move to LC, we would have probably ended up closing in 8 or 10 months. And we already closed a library, we already closed a bookstore in Laredo, so it is not fair to our kids to close the old children museum in 150 miles. So on behalf of all of our children, on behalf of our board, I want to thank you for that. Thank you very much. You know, have a good night.
Thank you, Mr. Perez.
Madam Chair.
Chair recognizes Mr. Delgado.
Call me. Do we need to recognize legal to say this, or can we motion to approve?
No, we can motion to.
Okay. Yes. Madam Chair, I motion to approve the building lease agreement between the Imaginarium of South Texas and Laredo College.
Second. So I have a first from Mr. Delgado, and I have a second from Mrs. Ramos. Any discussion? None heard. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries.
Welcome
Thank
home.
You. Welcome home, the Imaginarium. So the next item is assignment of architect for facilities master plan phase three projects. Mr. Cesar Vela.
Madam President, members of the board, we are recommending that the board approve the assignment of Cavazos and Associates Architects to be the architects of record for the Lamar Bruni Vergara Environmental Center project and the Law Enforcement Training Center project. The recommendation is being based on the percentage of the contracts that have been awarded. And as discussed in the building committee meeting, Cavazos Architects has received 17% of the total contract amount for phase three projects. With these assignments, he would move up to 21% at this point.
Okay. Any questions?
Madam Chair.
The chair recognizes Ms. Mares.
Yes, ma'am. I'm in order. I'd like to make a motion that we approve the appointment of Cavazos Architects for the Lamar Bruni Vergara Environmental Center and the Law Enforcement Training Center.
Second. So I have a first and I have a second by Mrs. Vela. Any discussion? Yeah. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Vela. Next item is approval of board member travel and reimbursement of reasonable travel expenses as per Laredo College board policies. BBG local board members compensation and expenses and BBH local board members conventions, conferences and workshop
Ms. Lupita Cepeda, Dr. Maricela Rodriguez Tijerina. And the item is 9E1, 2021 Association of Community College Trustees ACCT Leadership Congress. Dr. Tijerina.
Dr. Tijerina, for the record, so the 2021 Association Community College Trustees Leadership Congress, we have board members that have withdrawn interest, so we don't need to vote on that item anymore, just to let the group know.
So no one is interested?
No.
Okay. Chair recognizes Mrs. Ramos.
For the record, I was the one that was interested, but I rescinded my invitation. It was an invitation from ACCT to be part of a panel. And so because of the conflict with my schedule and everything else, I decided not to participate at this time, for the record.
Thank you, Mrs. Ramos.
Thank you.
Any other comments? Okay. So I'm gonna go, we don't need to vote on that. Mr. Mayor?
I believe that item
9E1,
there's no need to vote on that.
So the next item is 9E2, Texas Association of School Administrators, TASA, Texas Association of School Boards, TASB, TXEDCON21. Dr. Tijerina?
Yes, this was presented as it's a Texas Association of School Administrators. So to let the group know who is called for that is a public official of a school district, administrator or employee of a school district, member of the Council of School Attorneys, or an administrator or employee of an education service center.
Where's the college?
Chair.
Sorry.
Chair recognizes Mrs. Ramos.
With that information from Dr. Tijerina, I move that the board find that the TASA-TASB conference is not necessary or desirable to carry out the educational functions of the college district as required by board policy BBH local. That's my motion for 9E2.
So I have a motion by Mrs. Ramos.
May I explain it?
Yes.
It just means that she mentioned who it was for, the TASA and the TASB, and it is not for college. Yes. So I'm asking, my motion question is saying that we find that it is not necessary or desirable to carry out the educational functions of the college district as required by board policy, BBH local.
So I have a motion by Mrs. Ramos. Do I have a second?
Second.
Second by Mrs. Mares. Discussion. My only question to you, Dr. Tijerina, this particular training, since we have dual enrollment, mm-hmm. does that qualify any staff to attend?
No.
Or board members?
No, because they don't go there.
That's a good question. No, because we're still under the government, of the agency of the Texas Higher Education Coordinating Board.
Okay.
Madam Chair, may I?
Chair recognizes Mrs. Ramos.
Sorry. I just want to add to it. The reason I made my motion was because I was able to do my research as well, because I knew that item was coming on the agenda. And it is for school administrators, of course. And I did review the previous sessions, and I found that there were no sessions for the college dual enrollment, anything like that. It was basically focusing on the school boards and also focusing on the administration that governs the school districts. As a matter of fact, all the members of TASA and TASB are mm-hmm. school board, are school people. So that's the reason why I made my motion. I just wanted to make sure that I explained that.
Any other discussion?
No.
Okay.
Yes, we do.
I'm gonna call for the vote. Oh, do I have a quorum?
Yeah.
Two of them are out.
I think so, well, it depends how the vote's gonna go. But
yeah, we still have a quorum.
I would imagine.
We still have
one,
a quorum.
Two, three, four,
yeah.
Okay.
And
so
all,
no, he's out.
No, he's gone. He's
okay.
The flight took off.
Oh, okay.
So all in favor?
Aye.
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 So all five say aye?
Yes.
Any opposed? Motion carries.
Okay, cool.
Information items, 10A, enrollment update, Dr. Fred Solis.
Fred Solis, Vice President for Student Success and Enrollment, Madam Chair, President Tijerina, and colleagues. This evening, I'm going to qualify my statements by saying that the numbers I'm going to be presenting to you this evening are very preliminary. We've just started classes on Monday, and so we're still having some adjustments to enrollments that are taking place. However, the preliminary numbers are looking very promising, and that's what I would like to share with you all this evening. Overall, our total headcount, when we compare ourselves to last fall, we're up over 7%. And so that accounts for about 680 students. That puts us ahead of last fall semester. When we take a look at that student number and we break it down into the non-dual and dual, our non-dual headcount has grown by 14% for this fall semester. What that is suggesting is that the incentives that you voted on and approved to attract students did work. That's a very positive for the college because the non-dual enrollment is the fee-paying student. That's a very good point. However, we are having difficulties still with our dual enrollment, and as of now, we're down 2% on our dual enrollment, and that's due to multiple situations that are occurring within our school district partners. In some cases, campuses had changes in administration that are new to dual and so forth, and then in other cases, just students not necessarily interested in doing it at this time. But we're still working with the school districts to account for that. Currently, that 2% drop accounts for about 78 students, so I think between today and tomorrow, which is tomorrow will be the last day we can register, we may be able to make that up. The numbers that I'm sharing were as of this morning, so it doesn't account for all the activity today as well. In terms of semester credit hours, overall we're up 8% on our semester credit hours. When we look at the division between dual and non-dual, our non-dual semester credit hours are up by 11%. And as Mr. Vela pointed out during his presentation, we were targeting at least 54,000 semester credit hours, and that's where we're holding as of right now. And so unless something drastic happens, it looks like we may make the target that Mr. Vela had projected. The same thing has happened with our contact hours. We're up 9.5% in our contact hours. And when we break it down between both dual and non-dual, both of them are up as well. In the non-dual, that's 11% that's up, while in the dual, it's up by 4%. So again, as of now, very favorable numbers, but I do want to qualify that it's still preliminary. Classes did start on Monday, and so we're still going through class adjustments as students are switching out courses, and some are adding courses, and some are dropping courses at this time. I would be I'm available to entertain any questions the board may have.
Thank you. Chair recognizes Mrs. Ramos.
Sorry. I just want to add, there is a lot of fluidity right now happening at school.
Yes.
I can see it. People coming in, people leaving, withdrawing, and I've been seeing some of the classes that are not being taken advantage of.
Right.
So they are opting to withdraw completely and go online. And it is a great number of students. I mean, on a daily basis, we see between 3 and 4 students withdrawing from school. Mm-hmm. However, I don't know if that student was a prospective dual enrollment student, but I've been hearing that across the districts. Mm-hmm. And so I understand that our at the end of tomorrow, we should be able to start withdrawing and putting the no-shows on the students that have not appeared, but then the phone calls begin, confirming.
Right.
So I understand the numbers and how it's working.
Mm-hmm.
And so I commend the administration for coming up with a prospective idea to get the students to come in.
Sure.
And for the record, I want to say that my daughter is participating in the non-dual.
Okay.
She's taking 2 classes here.
Very good.
And she's at TAMIU, but she came back to take 2 classes here. So she was, also one of those students coming from TAMIU that is also correlating and getting some classes and finishing up. So definitely I understand the fluidity that's happening right now. And so we might not see a true outcome until maybe the middle of maybe the middle of September, maybe the late September, yeah. But it is, there's so much change going on. So
I do have to inform the board that we do have plans for a second start, which is a flex term for the fall. Nice. That will begin on October the 16th and then with our regular semester in December. Yeah. As of now, about 92% of those sections have already made, and so that's a promising effect that we're looking forward to launching in October. And so if the enrollments continue to hold, then those will be additional enrollments. Regrettably, because of when they're starting, those classes don't count for fall enrollments, but they will count for spring enrollments. Yeah. But overall, they'll be paying tuition and fees now. And so that's another element that we're looking at. I cannot say enough about not only your vision for approving the incentives and putting that together, but all the micro level efforts that have been put on across the college. And everybody from marketing to the services side to instruction and opening up sections and so on, each and everybody has contributed their little piece of contribution as they possibly can. But there's been a macro effect, which is reflected in our enrollment. So a lot of micro efforts, but a macro effect. And I just wanted to point that out.
Thank you, Dr.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Motion to defer.
Very good.
Thank you, Dr. Solis.
Thank you.
Very good news for us.
Yes.
Very good news.
The next item I have is the 10B, liability, ethics, and conflict of interest.
Madam Chair.
We Chair recognizes Mr. Delgado.
Madam Chair, if I'm in order, I'd, as instructed by legal, like to motion to defer agenda item 10B.
Second.
I have a motion by Mr. Delgado. I have a second by Mrs. Ramos. Discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? None. Motion passed to defer that item. Next item is 12B, rescinding acceptance of real property donated to Laredo College.
Madam Chair, am I in order?
Chair recognizes Mrs. Ramos.
I'd like to make the motion to rescind the acceptance of the real property donated to Laredo College as discussed in executive session with advice from legal counsel.
Second that motion.
So I have a first by Mrs. Ramos. I have a second by Judge Martinez. Any discussion?
Rusty has his hand.
Oh, sorry.
I'm sorry?
No, Rusty.
Chair recognizes Mr. Muir.
Just for the record, I'd clarify that the property was donated to the college on December 15, 2020, and the address is 1012 Vidaudi Avenue.
Okay. So I call for the vote. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. 12C, acknowledge Laredo College 2018-2021 safety and security audit. Dr. Arriasola. Or we just make a motion?
No, we just
make a motion.
Oh, we just make a motion.
Ms. Mares has her hand up.
So, Chair recognizes Ms. Mares.
Oh, okay.
You had your hand up.
I'd like to move that we go ahead and acknowledge the report given to us by staff regarding the 2018 to 2021 safety and security audit report, which, by the way, had very favorable and positive results. So, kudos second. To everyone.
So, I have a motion by Ms. Mares. I have a second by Ms. Ramos. Any discussion?
No.
None heard. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. President's report. Do you have anything, Dr. Tijerina?
No, Dr. Tijerina, it's all in your packet. So if you all have any questions, just let me know.
Okay. So the next meeting date is Thursday, September the 30th, 2021 at 6 p.m. And that's our regular Board of Trustees meeting. Do I have a motion for adjournment?
Motion.
So I have a first by Mr. Delgado, a second by Judge Martinez. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed?
Nobody.
No, I'm not going to ask for discussion because you're not going to discuss that.
No.
Discussion. Thank you, everybody.
I'd like to discuss.
Thank you.
Good night.
We stand adjourned.
Thank you, but I want to discuss.
I want to discuss.